Today, we are going to study the application of electron paramagnetic resonance spectroscopy to photochemical research. So, that is photochemistry and EPR. So, what happens when molecules absorb light?
Molecules are exposed to light. What happens?
So, when excited by light, of course, molecule will go to excited state, provided the light is absorbed by the molecule. Now, most of the molecules in the ground state are singlet. All electrons are paired. So, the first excitation usually brings the molecule to the singlet state, and from singlet state the molecule can go to triplet state, and in triplet state there are two unpaired electrons. And you know that unpaired electron means the system is paramagnetic. So, here two electrons are unpaired, so it will be paramagnetic species. So, the triplet can give rise to EPR spectra. Similarly, the excited molecule can undergo chemical reaction, and chemical reaction sometimes produces free radical, and free radicals also have unpaired electrons and they are paramagnetic, so they can give rise to EPR spectra. So, we have two types of possibilities. One is triplet, other is free radicals. And both can be studied by EPR spectroscopy. Today, we will concentrate on this aspect and not discuss the EPR spectroscopy of triplets. Now, free radicals, because they have unpaired electrons, usually they are very reactive. They always try to react with something else. So, it is very difficult therefore to capture them and see their EPR spectrum. So, it is not going to be easy task to capture this thing in the EPR spectrometer. So, it is possible that molecules absorb light and does some photochemistry, and they just the spectrometer is not able to detect them. So, then not seeing EPR spectrum does not necessarily mean the reaction is not taking place. But if you do see this thing, suppose EPR spectrum is seen, then there is unambiguous evidence that radical is formed, and whatever reaction mechanism one can think of is at least partly supported by the observation of this. What I am trying to say is that if you do not see any EPR spectrum of any radical, it does not mean it is not taking place. So, observation is a definitive proof, not observation is not the proof that it does not happen. So, that is why I have written in the slide that if detected, they give unambiguous evidence. So, because these are very short lived reactive radicals, how does one really detect them and try to capture them even if they are short lived? So, we have to find some way of doing the experiment. Unlike the examples that you have seen in the EPR lectures, almost all the radicals that we showed are stable, reasonably stable radical, so that you can scan the magnetic field very slowly and get the spectrum. Radicals do not die during the recording. Here, because they are short lived, some special techniques need to be adopted. The three ways one can do the experiment here shown in the slide. One is that continuous photolysis. Let the reaction be carried all the time and light is on the sample, and we can hope to get some steady state concentration of the radical, and that can be seen in a steady state EPR spectrometer. Another possibility is called spin trapping. In this spin trapping technique, this transient radical, that is radicals which do not live for a long time, they react with some other molecule to produce a relatively stable radical. So, this stable radical can be seen in the steady state EPR spectrometer. And third one is called time resolved EPR spectroscopy, where we try to capture the radical as soon as they are created, and we will see later how that is done. So this continuous photolysis. So here, to capture the radical as they are formed, we have to keep on continuing the photolysis and try to record the spectrum. So how that is done? So here, first I need to sunlight on the sample, and this should be done in situ. That is, we cannot carry this excitation somewhere else and bring the sample to the spectrometer and hope to get the spectrum. That is not possible. So it has to be done inside the spectrometer. To be specific, it has to be done inside the microwave cavity of the spectrometer. So how is it carried out? For that, here is a design. Let us say this is the microwave cavity and this is the iris tuning screw. So we could put a sample tube and let the sample which is kept here, reaction mixture, can be taken through a pump. And this is a low temperature bath, and through this liquid goes out here, and then again it can be brought back to this reservoir. Now here there is a hole which is kept here in front of the cavity, and light can enter through this, either laser light or it could even steady state lamp could be inserted here. So remember, the cavity looks like this. There is an iris hole, and this goes to the waveguide here. So far this end was blocked, but we could open a hole here and allow the light to go through. But the trouble is that if you allow light to go through and hole is drilled here, the microwave can also leak out of that. So that will reduce the Q of the cavity. So that is not very desirable. So what is done here is that some manufacturer, instead of opening a hole, they make a grid type of arrangement here. These tiny gaps are kept there, so that so far as the microwave is concerned, whose wavelengths are fairly big, they find that this is almost a continuous metal plane, so it will not escape. So this is one way of, but the allowing the light to go through this, these holes are thin. But the trouble of doing this is that much of the light is not penetrating, they are blocked by these grills here. So another technique is to actually have a hole here and let another piece of small waveguide which is mounted here, so that the wavelength of this is such that this really cannot sustain within this. This is much smaller dimension than this one, so this almost act like a tube which blocks the wave from entering here. So that way there could be a small slight loss of the cavity Q, but nevertheless this will work very well, particularly because since the hole is clear, all the light will go through the microwave cavity. And this thermostat arrangement, low temperature bath, and having the liquid to go through this, is to have some control on the temperature, because at lower temperature radicals could live for somewhat longer time, giving making it easier to record the EPR spectrum. Another possibility is that here there is a special tube which is used here, which looks like this. So sample, liquid sample enters here and then comes out, and through this it goes out here. And this is kept inside a standard variable temperature DOR insert, through which cold nitrogen gases pass through that. So that sample is cooled by this cold gas here, and if you flow this liquid reasonably slowly, then it will acquire some sort of steady state temperature, which is decided by the flow of this liquid, flow of this not liquid hydrogen, cold nitrogen gas. And the temperature is measured by this heater sensor assembly here, and the previous one temperature is measured by the thermocouple here. Here is an example now, having described how the experiment is done. This experiment involves exciting para-benzoquinone. In this, and if sign light and see what happens. So, the light is on all the time. So, the sample is flowing through this, and we are recording the steady state EPR spectrum the way we have described earlier. The experiment is very simple now, except for this special modification on the cavity and the flow system that is used to continuously replace the sample. So, here signal that is seen here is given in this slide. So, this is triplet, triplet, another triplet, triplet, this triplet, triplet. Overall you can see that this gap is same as this gap. We can now guess that without making any careful measurement, this gap is also same as this gap, and this each individual triplet also have similar high performance splitting. And overall this intensity of this and this follow 1:2:1. So, that means this radical has one spin, one proton. Now, I can say proton because the chemicals are made up of basically proton magnetic nuclei. So, this gives one proton of one number one, another proton which is number two of them, and another one which is 1. So, this gives a triplet, that is this 1:2:1. This one gives doublet. So, this is a mistake, because this also gives a triplet. So, this will be triplet. So, this is the type of radical which the radical should have this type of protons. So, here is the structure shown which is consistent with this spectrum, and that is so you see that one, this is one proton which gives a doublet splitting, and this are equivalent proton. So, they also give rise to a triplet, and another proton here and another one here, these two are also equivalent, but they are different from this. So, they give rise to a triplet. So, here this coupling constant due to one pair is different, quite different from the coupling constant of the other one. So, that is the way the spectrum looks like. So, this definitely shows that radical must be same. This is the only the possible radical that is consistent with the spectrum, and knowing the chemical nature of the reactant, nothing else can possibly give rise to similar EPR spectrum. So, the observation is therefore very very definitive. Right. So, if instead of now this isopropanol, if you take ethanol, let us see what happens. It will again looks that the similar pattern, triplet, triplet, this triplet, 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 triplet. So, this must be same radical as this one. But in addition, you see some smaller lines here, this one, this one, this one. So, what are these things? So, little hump is here. So, here then one can get some idea by measuring the relative heights of these intensities. So, even if the one, now that I see little bit here, and gap between this and this is same as between this and this, and between this and this. So, there should be a partner of this little line somewhere here, which even if I do not see it, I have to assume that it is there. And the intensity ratios of this turns out to be 1:4:6:4:1. So, this some other radical is also formed here along with this radical, and knowing the again the whatsoever chemicals are there, the most intelligent guess will be that this corresponds to here. So this is a sort of neutral semiconductor radical when OH is there, when this dissociates to make it anion radical, then it will have this one pair of protons and another pair of protons. Now here, because of the delocalization, or 4 protons become equivalent, and then I can get this sort of spectrum which is consistent with this. So for isopropanol I get this radical only, but in ethanol this radical is predominantly seen, but this is also seen to a certain extent. Another example, here we use this acetone plus isopropanol and sign light. So by the way, here the light that is used here, that light is absorbed by this one. This is the one which absorbs near UV region. This does not absorb. So this goes to excited state and does photochemistry and produces this radical. Similarly, here this carbonyl group here of acetone, that absorbs the UV light and that goes to excited state and reacts with this and produces some radical, and this is the result of that. So here these lines are seen, now 7 lines, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And if you see, it's maybe it is not very perceptible, but they don't quite look like one transition there. This is what I discussed in one of the earlier lectures, is that one has to be careful if there are overlap lines or they are not. So here, if one can see, this sort of discontinuities are there. So there is an indication that some other proton is also involved in coupling that. Of course, one can improve the resolution and get a more direct evidence of that. So here, after measuring the intensities of all the lines, one gets this sort of numbers, and that is consistent with 6 equivalent protons. And if you consider this little doublet, then the another proton which gives little small doublet, and the radical which is consistent with this EPR signal is this one. So here, so naturally here one can write the reaction mechanism that this excited state of this takes this hydrogen atom from here and produces this radical. It so happened that if you remove this hydrogen atom now, not the proton, so you bring it here, then this also becomes a free radical. So two of this thing forms there. So that is the way the steady state photolysis, and we can look at the radical directly if of course the circumstances are such that they are favorable, then we can get this radical directly there. Of course, the condition for this is that we are doing the continuous photolysis by shining light all the time and detect the spectrum. But radicals being short lived, they are also dying at the same time. So whatever the steady state concentrations that are built up here, they will contribute to the observed spectrum. So if the radicals don't have sufficient steady state concentration, it may be almost impossible to see the spectrum in this fashion. So here comes the other technique, that even if they don't live for a long time, if I allow the radicals to react with something else to produce some other radical, and if that radical has sufficiently long lifetime, then we could probably detect those radicals, the secondary radicals, and try to understand the reaction mechanism and probably make some guess about what the original radical that was. So this technique is called spin trapping EPR. You trap the free radical. So the idea is very simple, that R is transient radical, is some trapping agent. So this reacts with this to give another species which is trapped radical, and this has sufficient long lifetime and may be easier to detect. So these are some common trapping agent, and often they are the nitroso compound NO group. This is diamagnetic species. The radical comes here and attacks here to form a radical. This could presumably be should have sufficiently long lifetime and easy to detect. Another one is of this kind. So this radical comes and attacks here, produce a radical of this kind. then this could have a long lifetime, then you can see it. So one of the common trapping agent is this molecule called phenyl N-butyl nitrone, or called PBN. It is similar to this. So phenyl group is here. So here is an example. For example, that if ethyl radical is coming and attacking here, then the radical that forms is NO dot. So what will be the EPS spectrum of that? This oxygen has the radical center, so nitrogen nearby. So this will be triplet because of nitrogen spin 1. And then adjacent to that is this single proton which is coming from this trapping agent. So that gives a doublet. This is the type of splitting one gets for this sort of trapped radical. And since the actual radical is sitting somewhere here, which is rather far from this radical center, this spectrum does not depend very much on the type of radical which is seen in the spectrum. So it will often almost always be a triplet and is split by doublet because of this one. There could be very small difference of the coupling constants here. Nevertheless, by and large all the trapped radical gives similar EPR spectrum. So it is not a very characteristic evidence of what radical was trapped. All one can say is that some radical is trapped and one can think of forming a reaction mechanism. There is another common trapping agent, it is called DMPO. This is the structure of this. Now here this again same ethyl radical comes and attacks here, this place. Then this is the trapped radical. This can be detected in EPR spectrum. Here again the radical center is near nitrogen, so this gives triplet line. Then there is another proton here which also give a doublet. But here this splitting constant due to this is somewhat more sensitive to the presence of this radical because it is very near that one. So that is hydronic coupling constant of beta proton is reasonably sensitive to this. So it will be easier to make better intelligent guess about the type of radical by seeing how much of this splitting constant has changed. Here is an example. The parabenzoquinone, there was same experiment that we did in the steady state one, and we got only evidence of this radical without having any knowledge of what the other radical was. Parabenzoquinone, ethanol and DMPO, it gives some lines of this kind here. So here you see this doublet, some doublet may or may not be there. You have to make some careful observation and see that these are the signals coming from this adduct. This is the CH3CH2O radical which form an adduct with these two, give a radical of this kind. And other one is this one when you use ethanol, this is isopropanol. So this splitting constant is this very large splitting constant due to this for one trapped radical and somewhat smaller splitting constant due to this radical. So these values I write here. This nitrogen splitting constant is 13.64 Gauss. This beta coupling constant and similarly adduct with .80 Gauss and A is beta is equal to 21.0 Gauss. So here you see the difference in their hyperharmonic coupling is quite appreciable when this adduct is formed and this adduct is formed. So that way DMPO is a much better trapping agent for identifying the radical that is trapped there. But problem with spin trapping is that, as I said earlier, it is very difficult to often identify the radical that is trapped unambiguously. Sometimes the trapping agent itself may react with the light and then produce some radicals with solvent. And sometimes the trapped radical may not be the radical that one has in mind while formulating the reaction mechanism. And finally, even if the spin trapping technique yields no signal, it doesn't mean the radical is not forming. Finally, quickly go through this time resolved EPR spectroscopy, where we try to capture the EPR spectrum of a radical which is right at the time of their formation and before they react. So, for that we use a usually pulse laser light or electron beam pulses, and spectra are detected at different times after the generation radical. That is why it is called time resolved EPR. And naturally, it needs a fast response EPR spectrometer and a pulse source of light or electron, because you have to compete with the reaction of the radical. So, this is the one I said earlier, is that we use direct detection EPR spectrometer, and we do not use the field modulation technique, simply get the output from the preamplifier. But to improve the signal noise ratio, we do signal averaging. And so, signal averaging is done in this way. Suppose the laser is operated in repetitive mode, and every time microwave signal looks very similar. So, we try to get, let us say, a small portion of the voltage at a given time after the laser, here given blue block here, and average this many times. There is a device called boxcar averager. Its job is just that, take a sample of the voltage at a given time and then average it out. So, if you plot this voltage at this time after the laser pulse, while scanning the magnetic field, I can get the time resolved EPR spectrum of the species at this time after the laser pulse. Here is an example. The duroquinone is dissolved in this triethylamine solvent, and then a laser UV laser light was shown on that, and this is the type of radical spectrum I get. So, this corresponds to the duroquinone anion radical of this one. This is the duroquinone anion radical. Here, as I said earlier, as a direct detection technique gives the absorption spectrum, but here the way we have adjusted the spectrometer, that it is supposed to give the absorptive signal, but everything comes in the opposite direction. That is very strange, that as if the signal is in the emissive form. It is indeed very strange, so we will not try to explore why it is so, but we will postpone it for later discussion. We can do another experiment, that instead of getting the spectrum as a function of magnetic field, we can hold the magnetic field in any place we like, and then see the microwave signal as a function of time now, and average the whole thing by using a very fast transient analog to digital converter. So, transient digital converter will capture the signal in digits at sort of sampling rate of certain given by the user. So, this various digital values are added to generate the average value of signal by adding several of these transients. So, here is an example. So, again duroquinone signal as a function of time, it forms a negative direction, again slowly goes to near zero. So, this time is of the order of few microseconds. If you increase this time to several hundred microseconds, one can clearly see that signal first starts emissive and then goes to absorptive and then goes to zero. So, presumably something is happening here, and then radical is decaying in this fashion. So, this is the two dimensional spectrum one can create by getting similar spectrum at different magnetic field. And so, one axis is magnetic field axis, other time axis. So, the example that we saw earlier in the steady state photolysis, acetone and isopropanol gives the absorptive spectrum of this kind. This is the derivative signal, but if we imagine that this is the way the absorptive signal is, and this experiment using time resolved spectroscopy gives completely different type of signal intensities. This is steady state spectrum, here the time resolved spectrum. You see how some of them are emissive, some are absorptive, and even doublet signals much seen much more clearly here. So, naturally something unusual information is contained in this time resolved EPR spectroscopy. So, it seems therefore, the spin population does not follow the Boltzmann distribution. Boltzmann distribution ensures the lower level are more popular than the higher level, but here things are all getting quite different. So, this set of information one can therefore get in experiment of this kind, and this phenomenon is called electron spin polarization. Right now, we simply learn that it is possible to detect such phenomenon, and why it is so will therefore involve a further discussion which will take up in a subsequent lecture.